see.
So we have a number of questions that come in each week. This one here is based on, basically, what is the best vegetable you can plant in a raised bed? Well, that's a pretty broad question, but I'll give you a simple answer from our experience. Anything will grow in a raised bed that will grow in the ground. However, we have found with a raised bed, you have good, loose, nutrient-rich soil. So we have found that root crops such as onions, leeks, carrots, parsnips grow phenomenal in a raised bed, even large grow bags for that matter. Anything root crop-wise to allow that root to develop, beets grow very well in a raised bed as well, or in a container, a grow bag.
Sometimes you want to think about where you're putting that raised bed if that's an option for you.
Because you're not moving this thing.
Because you're not moving that thing, so you have to be very diligent if you're going to build one.
But yeah, peppers, eggplants, all the other stuff grows great too.
Yeah. I had blossom end rot on my tomatoes last year. I've heard of adding Epsom salt to the hole at the time of planting and to water with it as well. Is this the best way? Well, Epsom or blossom end rot is actually a lack of calcium in your soil.
A lack of available pickup
available,
calcium,
yeah,
for the plant.
Yeah, that too. A lack of available calcium. So a lot of times what happens is that you get your garden planted, your plants start flowering, you're really excited, and then you forget about watering. Maybe it's we're moving into the droughtier parts of summer. So you want to make sure you're watering, because what will happen is that you'll add Epsom salt, you'll water with Epsom salt, and then all of a sudden the blossom end rot goes away. But what happens is that you watered and that allowed for the calcium to release itself into the plant and be uptaken by the roots of the plant.
Right. Calcium is calcium. Epsom salt is magnesium sulfate.
Right. So calcium is something that exists in your soil, but you just have to be watering. So you can use irrigation. You can just make sure you get yourself on a watering schedule. But watering is the most important thing, especially because when it gets towards the warmer parts of summer, we might not have as much rainfall. You want to keep that up.
1 inch of water a week per plant. So how you figure this out? You take a tuna can, a 1 inch tall tuna can or chicken can, and put next to the tomatoes, and then water, not trying to get on the plants, but and then once that fills up, then you have equated that one inch of water a week for that. So keep that in mind. We want to mulch as well, and that prevents the splash up of soil, the splash up of soil on the leaves, which causes the predominant amount of fungal issues and is, you know, 90% of the problems your tomato plant's going to face is soil splashing up on the leaves. But in addition to that, watering correctly will greatly reduce blossom end rot, and you don't have to use Epsom salt because it doesn't have no functionality to
for the calcium.
Not for the calcium at all. So it does do that as well. We often get questions that we refer and reach out to other sources to get the correct answer for you. So we're going to do that. We're going to turn over a couple of questions to Standard Process Farmhand. Standard Process is your trusted whole food supplement manufacturer with 90 years of experience. To find the best supplements for you and find a local healthcare professional that can do that, go to standardprocess.com/patient. So here's the question. So Sarah M. From Park City, just north of Wichita, Kansas, writes in with her question. I have a very hard time trying to grow broccoli and cauliflower. I get stalks, but very little to no heads. Any advice can you offer me before I give up and just buy my broccoli and cauliflower from the farmer's market and plant something else in that spot? Well, we'll turn this over to Christine. She's the farm manager over at Standard Process, and see what she can advise us, because we had this problem as well.
Hi, Christine Mason, farm operations manager at Standard Process in Palmyra. We start about 70,000 broccoli at a time. So we have a lot of experience with broccoli here at Standard Process. And the thing about these vegetables is they like it colder. And I think a lot of people try to do them in the summer when it's really not their season. So we start them around St. Patrick's Day. We make sure we have a very nice transplant. We put them outside and let them stiffen up and get nice and tough before we put them in the soil. Do it early. They like it cold. You don't have to worry about them freezing at 32. They don't like it 20 either, but stick them out early, eat them early in the summer, and every time you have a head, if you cut it off, your plant might give to you longer than you think. Good luck!
70,000 broccoli cauliflower plants. That's quite a undertaking there. Next question we have is from Becky from Milwaukee. I know how important bees are in the garden, and I want to plant a pollinator garden. What flowers or plants would you recommend for that? We'll take that back out to Christine, farm manager at Standard Process, and see what she has to offer on that question from Becky.
Pollinators are something we're very passionate about at Standard Process. 85% of all flowering plants and two-thirds of the food we eat rely on pollinators, and they're having a hard time in the United States. Every person that has a plot of land can help with pollinators, no matter if your yard is large or small. And we rely on the Xerces Society. You could go to xerces.org, and you can look up your specific region of the United States, and they will give you the plants that would help the most pollinators in your garden.
And there you go. Thank you very much, Christine, for the information on broccoli, cauliflower, and pollinators. Before